The ocean is dying. We have rising ocean temperatures that we see all the time. We see reefs dying, we see overfishing. I believe that humans can solve any problem if they have the right incentive system to do so. My name is Lucas Müller. I'm a marine biologist and a shark researcher.
My name is Lennart Rossenfeld, and I'm an underwater and nature cameraman.
When I take my last breath and I descend underwater, I can feel my heart rate slow down. I'm flying in a three-dimensional space. I'm almost like an astronaut bouncing around slowly in a different world.
You are floating. You are kind of flying above this ecosystem. It really shows you the sound of silence.
There's no distraction, you're completely in the moment. Everything else disappears. There's like a vroom. And that's when there's this big shadow of a tiger shark swims over the reef and swims past you. And in that moment, you feel insignificant. This animal, it shows you that you're not on top of the food chain. It puts you in your place. It's not fear, but it's a deep sense of gratitude that you were able to experience that. I think it's the most addicting experience in life.
Definitely.
What has happened is that in my industry, in conservation and science, funding has decreased. And then I realized that it's not possible to do it on your own. So what we came up with, let's build a team. Let's work with a cameraman, with a scientist, with a marine biologist, and let's see if we can find a new concept to make this sustainable.
I think the dream of Ocean Collective is to build a platform which makes it able to open the world of research, the ocean, to get more awareness about what we are doing and to show how in danger this world is.
So what we're trying to do in this incubating hub of Ocean Collective is we try to have a positive vision. Why not, you know, try and be as inclusive as possible and invite people to do that? Say, come. They learn freediving, they come on an expedition, they help us do the research, so we have to do less fundraising, and in the end they have a great adventure. What I really learned from Fortis was that a partnership that is based on common values can be super potent if you commit and have the courage to go a path that goes against the mainstream and beyond the super short attention span that we have today. You know, now we see what's maybe possible in another 5 or 10 years, giving us the commitment to continue this. When you interact with any type of animal, then your body language is what determines how that animal thinks about you and how you think about even yourself. If you are frantic, if you don't take space, if you don't make the animal feel by just looking at it that you demand a certain type of respect, then they're going to start testing boundaries. However, especially when we work with very sensitive animals like whales, dolphins, even some shark species like a blue shark, for example. A blue shark is at like 1.2 meters. Then you need to be able to exactly be that calm teacher and make yourself small, because I want the shark to come in. So in a way, those animals teach you a lot about body language that now today actually helps us with humans when we interact on land.
You cannot control the animal. It's very important to have a strict rule to say we just do it 5 times. And after that, if it don't work, we continue with the next shot.
For us, the key has been to build up this trust and this communication system, which today works. Now we have our own language underwater, because underwater, you can talk to each other. So you need to find a non-verbal form of communication. So for example, if I tell Lenny, we need to go up, then I do this. If I say we abort the dive, we do this. A super special moment was when we went to Tiger Beach, a hotspot for grown, big, strong tiger sharks in the Bahamas. And there's one tiger shark, her name is Emma. She's the most famous tiger shark in the world, and she has this super soft energy. She lured me into this sense of security, almost like a motherly kind of presence. Whenever you engage in an activity that captures your attention, where you go into a flow state, then what happens is my subjective mind tricks me and I lose a sense of time. That, in our line of work, can be freaking dangerous. And just this habit of checking your time regularly because you feel something, something is connected to your wrist that reminds you objectively to get snapped back into reality and stick to a plan that both of you have agreed upon, is gold, is everything. So it saved my butt quite a bit.
Yeah. Especially when you are scuba diving, it's very important to know when you jumped in and when you came out and on which depth you are. So for me, the Marine Master is my backup system. Yeah, it gives me the safety because it never failed. It has no battery and it still works all the time. I think the most challenging shoot we've ever had was in the Arctic Circle in the north of Norway, where we tried to find the orcas and film them how they hunt the herring.
When you dive with orcas, it's not the calm marine biology vibe that you think, you know, this job entails. It's super quick, super fast, and there's a slight tension because you can see the sun already going down. There's only 2.5 hours of sunlight in Norway at that time of the year. And it's pitch black dark, and suddenly you get stung in the face by the cold ice water.
Was bloody cold. I trained for it, I don't know, half a year to handle the cold. And if you're telling me now to jump then in the water, I would say never. But if you know down there in a pitch black water there are hunting orcas, that's a different thing.
To see those big white dots of a fully grown orca swim right at you, and oh, I get goosebumps now when I think about it. And we're working. Lenny is at 10 meters on scuba. I'm freediving. We try to be close to each other for safety. And at some point, I look. It's eerily quiet. Come back up and I realized there's a blizzard, there's a snowstorm coming over the mountain into the fjord. And I'm like, okay, shit. I go down, I say, Lenny, we need to go up. And he comes up, but slowly because he's on scuba, he can't rush up. So what would have happened if we hadn't discussed this sign language and that level of attention beforehand? We would be gone. This was unexpectedly close.
Mm-hmm. It was a very close call, yeah.
So what the Arctic taught us is it doesn't matter if we tell great stories. It doesn't matter if we, you know, research the oceans and work for its protection. If one day we don't come back from sea, we have family, we have people that support us, and we want to come back. And that's where I value Lenny's friendship, because I'm more the person that likes to push boundaries, and he's a little bit more conservative, and we seem to meet at a really good middle ground.
Yeah.
I love you.
You too.